American University of Beirut. He had his pediatric and allergy immunology fellowship training at the Children's Hospital in Boston at Harvard Medical School. Throughout his distinguished career, Professor Geha received many national and international awards. Latest is the American Association of Immunologists Award for the Human Immunology Research in 2010. He served as director of the American Board of Allergy and Immunology, president of Clinical Immunology Society, and currently he chairs the International Union of Immunological Societies. Professor Geha trained more than 100 fellows in allergy immunology in the past 30 years. And among them, of course, is myself, which I'm proud to be. And he authored more than 340 original articles, 170 review articles, and 7 books and chapters. So without overdue, let me welcome Professor Geha for us, with us today. Professor Geha, first lecture will be about atopic dermatitis.
Thank you, Abdullah, for this very nice introduction. Appreciated, although not deserved. And thank you for inviting me here. I have very good memories of Riyadh. I was here the first time where many of you in the room were not born yet, back in 1978 when I came to do some temporary summer job at King Faisal Specialist Hospital. So it brings fond memories when I come here. We have in my lab a couple of interests. One of them is atopic dermatitis, and the reason we got into that was a very strategic reason. There were too many people working in asthma, and I am meeting with some people later today advising them about their career. It's always very good to choose a niche where it is not very crowded. And I was always fascinated by this disease because it affects a lot of children, as you know. 5 to 15% of the children in various countries have atopic dermatitis. And it also is the allergic diseases that usually precedes the others. So it starts very early in infancy. So my talk today says, the title is From Bench to Bedside. And it is missing really from bedside to bench to bedside, because it is all based on some clinical observation. But what we feel we do best, at least from my group, is to use animal models to test some pathways and then go back to the human. And we have a group, some of you know Linda Schneider and others within our department, that have a clinical program for atopic dermatitis, where some of these therapies that are come on the horizons are hopefully tested. And today during the talk, I will suggest that there are some other interventions that we can do, because the disease still is problematic. It's treated in a totally symptomatic way. And it's a major burden for the children and for the parents. So what we are going to talk to, do a little overview of the disease, and then focus on the issue that is really critical to this disease, and which is mechanical injury, because this disease starts by scratching. And I will show you that even if you scratch a normal person, maybe I have one slide on a normal person, and that's me and my colleague Hans Oetken, then you can cause an inflammation that could develop into atopic dermatitis. So this is a disease of scratching, with the appropriate immune system, of course, in the background. And so we're going to talk about what is this mechanical injury to the skin by scratching does when your antigen enters at the site of injury, because that's what the children do. They scratch their skin, and the antigens come in through the skin. And why do they then develop an allergic response, a systemic allergic response? Whereas if you give somebody an injection through the skin, which we do every day for people who children, immunized children, then you do not develop an allergic response. But this one, if you scratch the skin and then put the antigen through that scratch, you develop the response. And then how the T cells go back to the skin, because this is a T cell mediated disease. And we knew that back in 1978, when 76, when we started transplanting children with the Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome who have atopic dermatitis. And actually, the first child transplanted was from Lebanon. He was one of my patients who followed me back to the United States. And we had a partial take, and when the T-cell took at the beginning, when the T-cell took over, the new T-cell, the eczema was cured. Of course, we had to transplant him again to get the platelets going. But so it's a T-cell disease. And finally, I want to talk about something that's very a complication of atopic dermatitis, which is the skin thickening. And why did that develop? And because it's really the most annoying thing in this disease on the long term, on those patients who persist having disease to adult life. And I'll say a few words about the relationship with food allergy. Maybe time will be short and I will skip one of these topics, but we will see. So, Oh, I'm having still trouble. Okay. So I don't need to tell this audience about this disease, but the picture says it all. This is a child who is scratching, is having an inflammatory lesion. Usually there is other members of the family who have the same problem. And also it is known to be triggered by allergen exposure. And you could put a patch test on this child, either with an airborne allergen he's allergic to. You can just apply a patch on his skin, and that's often done in Europe, you can put an food antigen to which he's sensitive, and you can trigger a skin reaction. I have to learn this so that I don't drive you all nuts. Help? Okay. Maybe. All right. I think I got it. Thank you. So the issue becomes, why does this scratching end up with a immune reaction characterized mostly what is called a Th2 response, that is the second line there, cells that are making IL-4 and IL-13 are the cells that you find in the skin, and it is IL-4 and IL-13 that are also driving an IgE response. So it is a response that's predominantly a Th2 or / allergic response with IL-4, IL-13, eosinophilia in the blood, eosinophilia in the skin, and also a big IgE response that can predispose to various mast cell diseases, etc. Okay. How do I do? What is exactly that I do? Okay, good. And is there a pointer? Okay. So this is actually a histology of a skin lesion that we made many, many, many years ago, where one of my fellows, Donald Leung, who now edits the Journal of Allergy and Clinical Immunology, and he did a biopsy of the skin of acute atopic dermatitis and chronic atopic dermatitis. And the skin that is acute is infiltrated a lot by eosinophils, and you usually don't see them much in human, but you see their products. So if you stain for their products, you see them. And they have CD4 cells, and it's a red erythematous pruritic lesion, and you have a lot of Th2 cytokines in the skin. As the lesion becomes chronic, you have more collagen deposition, interferon gamma production, the lesion gets thickened, and it gets this rough appearance. So the issue is, so we went and decided that if scratching is very important, let's test it in an animal model, because we can manipulate the animal model much better than the human. And the animal model we use is shown here. You take any normal mouse, usually we use white mice, shown up right upper corner, and you scratch the skin. You take a piece of 3M tape and you tape strip the skin as an equivalent or surrogate of scratching. And then you apply the antigen under a patch so it cannot remove it for a week. Then you rest and you do it 2 more times. And in the end, you end up with a situation where you have a histopathologic lesion and an immunologic lesion that looks exactly like the human lesion. And there are really 2 cardinal features of eczema, skin lesion. One of them is the increase in epidermal thickness, which you see up there. On the left side is patches treated with skin patch treated with saline, tape stripped and treated with saline. And on the right side is the one treated with an antigen from eggs of albumin. And you can see there's epidermal thickening, dermal thickening with infiltration of eosinophil. And if you look at the cytokines present in the skin, they are mainly Th2 cytokines, IL-4 and IL-13. But also there is another Th2 cytokine that is very important for itching, and it is IL-31, because if you put IL-31 in the skin of an individual, they start itching. There are also little, not much interferon at all, and some IL-17 in the skin. If you look at the systemic response, they are making all these cytokines, but only the 4 and 13 are expressed in the skin, and we will talk about it later. And they make IgE and IgG1 and all that. So why is it, how do we go from scratching the skin to make a Th2 response? Because we're starting here with a normal mouse. And so the issue is that the antigen, when it enters the skin, is taken by dendritic cells, and when you are injuring the skin, you are doing two inseparable things. You have to do them at the same time. You cannot separate them. One of them, you are inciting an inflammatory response by the mechanical injury, and the other one, you are, and the antigen is being, thank you, is taken up by the dendritic cells, digested, and Larry Steinman, who discovered dendritic cells, just died, as you know, 2-3 days before he got his Nobel Prize, and those are very important antigen processing cells that take the cell, the antigen from the skin, and travel down to the draining lymph node in your axilla, if your skin exposure is here, and they meet the circulating T cells and elicit a response. So you can isolate the dendritic cell directly from the skin, or you can also isolate them from the draining lymph node and see what is the effect of mechanical injury. And if you do that, and there are various ways you can do that, you can study the dendritic cells themselves, you can put them antigen on them in the test tube and ask them to present it to T cells. You could do various things. You could do functional assays, you could see expression profile assays, and you find that you really, in the conditions of mechanical injury, these dendritic cells, when you use them to present antigen, they selectively, those that are coming from the dendritic cell always incite something, even without injury. They will incite T cells to proliferate and to make IL-4 and IL-13 and interferon gamma. But if they are coming, if they are isolated from a skin that you have scratched, then they are much more potent inducer of selectively of the Th2 cytokine IL-4 and IL-13. Therefore, the injury has instructed the dendritic cells to do that. And this instruction is taken down to where it meets the T cells, and you can trace that dendritic cell by putting a fluorescent antigen, waiting 24 hours into the, and then taking the lymph node out, and you can separate on the cell sorter those cells and compare those that are coming from uninjured skin, those versus those coming with a scratched skin, which is the red arrows are around. So you can make a side-by-side comparison, and if you do that, and this is how we sort these cells, they have markers, so they are carrying the antigen, which is fluorescent. They have the CD11C marker. You isolate this portion of cells here from just shaved skin, and this is shaved and tape-stripped skin. And as you can see, the percentages are small, but if you kill 20 mice, and that's what fellows are good, rather kill the mice than kill me, then you end up with enough cells to do the experiment, and if you do that experiment, you find that those coming from shaved and tape-stripped skin, when you look at the IL-4 and 13, they are much potent inducers than those coming only from shaved skin or from directly the lymph node without any manipulation of the skin. So that you are twisting the arm of the dendritic cell to do that. And what if you do a number of expression marker on these dendritic cells, they express markers like IL-10, JAG2, and JAG1 that are known to induce Th2 cytokine production in T cells, and they don't express the IL-12, which is the key cytokine to express to induce interferon production. So you force them into a pathway where they become what we call DC2, which is really dendritic cells that induce Th2 cells. So what? There are many factors that happen in the skin when you scratch it. You get a burst of IL-1, IL-60, and F within really a couple of hours, but also you release this molecule from keratinocyte called TSLP for thymic stromal lymphopoietin, and you also express other molecules that are coming from keratinocytes, such as the cytokine IL-33, which promote, both of those promote Th2 cell maturation. And you can show by using animals that cannot respond to TSLP, such as TSLP receptor deficient mice, that you cannot induce an allergic skin reaction in them. So they have a problem, they educate T cells, but those T cells don't make IL-4 and IL-13 in the skin, and the T cells that appear in the skin are not Th2 cells, and you have no eosinophils. So this TSLP is important, and it is important not only because it is released early, you have to remember that the child with eczema is scratching all the time, so he's scratching even after he has developed a lesion, and the presence of TSLP, continuous presence in the lesion, is important for the T cells that come back to that lesion to make enough IL-4 and IL-13. So if you take a situation in which you have kind of an established lesion and you inject TSLP, you decrease the amount of IL-4 and IL-13. So therapies that are directed to TSLP could potentially work at two steps during the response. The initial step where you educate the dendritic cells, which then educate the T cells to make an allergic response, and also when the T cells come back to the skin, in order for them to express their full potential, you need to SLP. And that's really the clinical situation. You don't treat the children before they develop eczema. You most of the time see them after they develop eczema, and that's where you want to intervene. Now, the scratching remains critical because it is scratching also that plays a very, very important role in bringing T cells back to the skin. So let's go back to the scenario. You have got the antigen first. The antigen has gone to the lymph node, to the dendritic cells. It has met there the T cells that are continuously entering and exiting the lymph node. It has allowed them to expand and bias them to make IL-4 and IL-13, but those T cells need to come back to the skin. And as a matter of fact, if you do look at the role of scratching, it is very important in preparing the field for the T cell to come in. So this is a human experiment, and actually this is my own skin, and this is unscratched, and this is scratched, somehow it got lost. And this is a mouse skin in which it is unscratched, and this is tape stripped. And I told you that tape stripping is a surrogate for scratching. And this is taken 24 hours later. And what you can see here is very quickly, skin usually has very, very little neutrophil. Very quickly there is a big increase in the number of neutrophil in the skin, both in the human and in the mouse, and there is a big increase in the leukotriene B4, which is a product of the leukotriene pathway from arachidonic acid, and also in the receptor for that leukotriene B4. The leukotriene pathway has two branches, and we will talk a little about both branches. One of them, in which you take the precursor and you make them into LTB4 through the action of an enzyme called LTA4 hydroxylase, and the other one, the cystinyl leukotrienes that we are all familiar with because Montelukast, which is used in asthma, is a cystinyl leukotriene receptor inhibitor, and I will come to that in a minute. So we're talking about the branch that causes LTB4. Why LTB4 is important? Because it's a chemoattractant in neutrophil. And what I will show you in a minute without going much into the detail is that the neutrophil there is a wave of neutrophil that comes in after scratching immediately within an hour or two, very small wave. And that's because of all the IL-1 and IL-6 and all the injury, non-specific injury things. The neutrophil come in, they start making their own LTB4 and they start getting their friends again. They start getting more neutrophils from the blood, who gets more neutrophil. And this reaction really prepares the field for the T cell to come in, and I will show you how. So this is only to show you that the LTB4 and all this comes from really neutrophil, because if you take a mast cell deficient mouse, then everything still is fine. You get the neutrophil and you get the LTB4 and its receptor accumulating in the skin. But if you deplete the mouse on neutrophil by various strategy, including using cyclophosphamide, then you deplete the ability of the mice to the ability of the neutrophil to accumulate in the skin. And this amplification pathway I told you about is shown here. If you don't have if you have a mouse with no BLT1 receptor, so it doesn't see LTB4, there is a very little influx. Or if you have a mouse that cannot make LTB4, there is also very little neutrophil influx. And this is interesting because we'll come back to later. This is a drug, bestatin, which inhibits the production of LTB4, and it also inhibits the accumulation of neutrophil. There is a little burst, but then it's not much accumulates. Now, this is a little complicated experiment, but it's important to understand how it, what we're trying to do here. You immunize mice, either, as I showed you, you can get T cells to become active in these wild-type mice, than normal mice, or you can immunize mice that do not have this BLT1 receptor. And what you are trying, and then you take the T cells from these mice and you put them in recipients that are wild-type or deficient in BLT1. Let's just look at the first line. This experiment here, which shows you that there is much less reaction when your donor has no receptor for LTB4, is consistent with previous studies in asthma that shows that the expression of the LTB4 receptor on T cell is important for inflammation. So here the T cells can't go. Here, on the second line here, your donor, your recipient, is deficient, but here even the normal T cells don't go into the recipient. So really what this experiment is showing, it's a crisscross experiment. It's showing that you need to express this receptor on both T cells and non-T cells. And the reason for that is that both the T cell and the neutrophil have to express this receptor. And the reason is that the neutrophil has to come in first and make enough LTB4 for the T cell to come. So it's a sequential thing. You scratch, the neutrophil comes, you make more LTB4. And then if you have sensitized cells from a previous exposure, then they come in. And I'm going to skip maybe a slide or two here, but here show you that if you don't have the receptor for LTB4, you do not develop the experimental atopic dermatitis. And here to show you that the same experiment I showed you before, these are wild T-type T cells that are coming into BLT1 recipient. They don't cause any reaction because you don't have the neutrophil that can come in the site. But if you add to here, that's the negative, the control, no neutrophil. If you add wild-type neutrophil to them, you get an inflammatory reaction compared to this one. And, of course, if you do put BLT1 deficient neutrophil, you don't see anything. This is to prove that you really need both BLT1 on both the T-cell and the B-cell. And is this applicable to the clinical situation? Well, as I said before, you have a child who is already sensitized. But then you quiet this child. You give them medication, or you take them to somewhere where there's not much allergen, and you control the itching, and you have no more lesions. But then he starts scratching again. So now, when he starts scratching again, if the theory is correct, he is calling in the neutrophil first, and then calling the T cell second. What if you block the neutrophil influx? With this drug, bestastatin, that I showed you, block the neutrophil influx when I scratch the mouse skin. So these are mice that were sensitized completely, then rested a little, and actually tested at a different site with the antigen. We tape strip previously unsensitized site. And if you do that, you get a very strong reaction, as shown here. If you don't treat the animal with anything, you can see the change on that site from very nice epidermis to a very thick epidermis, same magnification, and the cellular infiltrate, and increase epidermal thickness, and increase in T cells. And the eosinophil is not shown. Now, if you treat this mouse here with the LTB4 blocker, then you don't develop anything. You don't develop any of that epidermal thickness. You do not develop the IL-4. You do not develop the CD4 cells, and you do not develop the IL-13. So these drugs pose a very interesting possibility because they work at two levels, at the level of the neutrophil coming in through this LTB4 chemoattractant, and also the Th2 cells coming in through the same LTB4 chemoattracting. And I think this is why the experiment worked very well here, where you completely abolished everything. There is really no signal. And funnily enough, this is a new concept. We're actually sending the paper very soon, and hopefully some clinical researchers, companies, will be interested in that, testing these drugs for the ability to block asthma. So in summary, neutrophil influx to the skin and their subsequent local production of LTB4 is essential for BLT1-dependent homing of antigen-specific CD4 memory T cells that make these cytokines to cutaneous side. And interfering with neutrophil homing with LTB4 synthesis inhibitor might be useful in AD. Now, I told you about skin thickening, and I told you that there is another group of that now we will touch on the other side, cysteine leukotriene, which is the which are inhibited by montelukast because it binds to their type 1 receptor. So the other type of cysteine leukotriene have two receptors, cysteine leukotriene 1 and cysteine leukotriene 2, and the montelukast is directed at cysteine leukotriene 1. And montelukast, as you know, is much used for rhinitis and asthma. So this child who itches, eventually, if he keeps on itching, he's going to get all, and the reaction perpetuated, he's going to get all these thick skin and collagen deposition. And indeed, in this model I showed you, there is, after 7 weeks, there is a collagen deposition in the skin that you can see here. So this is the mouse treated with saline. And that's the amount of collagen. This is a chemical assay for collagen in the skin. And this is the mouse that is treated with OVA, and there is a big collagen deposition. This Delta DBL Gata mouse is a mouse made by my colleague Stuart Orkin, who is a hematologist, and it does not have eosinophil. So that immediately shows you that there is no dermal thickness, no epidermal thickness, and no collagen deposition if you don't have eosinophils. So eosinophils are very important and are present in human skin. They degrade very quickly in the lesion, so you stain for their product, like EPO and MBP, and you see them. So why are eosinophils doing this? Well, I think they are doing this because they are factories for making the other type of leukotrienes, maybe LTC4, and its products, LTD4, etc., and LTE4. Because if you take a mouse that has lacking the enzyme for making these cysteine leukotriene, you notice two things. The reaction is much milder, not only the epidermal thickness, but also the collagen deposition there is no significant increase in collagen deposition. So you need the leukotriene to do cysteine leukotriene, and you need the eosinophil. So does that mean the eosinophil is the source of the leukotriene? Because there are some other cells. And the answer is yes. And the way we showed that is that if you take these LTC4 deficient mice that cannot make the reaction I showed you, and if you reconstitute them, this is, you can grow eosinophil, by the way, from bone marrow very, very nicely. You can purify them to almost 90% purity. If you give this mouse that cannot make leukotriene just eosinophil from a normal mouse, you reconstitute the collagen deposition and you reconstitute the thickness of the dermis and the epidermal thickness. But if you give it as a control, eosinophil taken from a mouse that does not have, from a sister mouse or brother mouse that does not have the capacity to make leukotriene C4, then you cannot restore the collagen deposition. So the question becomes, since leukotriene C4 are important, can we use the current inhibitor, which is montelukast, to decrease skin thickness? As I told you, the leukotriene, cysteine leukotriene, have two receptors, 1 and 2, and montelukast is directed against number 1. So is our reaction here driven by the type 1 receptor, and therefore montelukast is already approved drug, or driven by the type 2 receptor? And luckily, friend and colleague next door, Frank Austin, has mice that are deficient either in the 1 receptor, which really doesn't make any difference, they still have collagen, or mice different in the L2 receptor. And it turns out it is the L2 receptor that is the one that is mediating this effect. And we didn't believe it until we did the other experiment. We were somehow like to check things in vitro as well as in vivo. And actually, if you take a human fibroblast, again mine, in the freezer available for the last 25 years, we thawed a vial of them, and you put LTC4, and the sequence is LTC4 get converted to D4 to E4. It is the first one. You have some very nice collagen synthesis in vitro, and you cannot inhibit it with montelukast, but you can inhibit it with this compound that blocks. It's not clinically available, yet, L2 receptor antagonists, I guess there is no need to use them. But in this system, they become as a potential target. So hopefully somebody would be interested in making these antagonists that work on the type 2 receptor as potential blockers of deposition. And forget about this. This is only to show you that they induce the fibroblast to make products that now get the keratinocyte to proliferate. You remember you saw also an inhibition of epidermal thickening. So these drugs will, blocking this receptor will only also decrease epidermal thickness. I'm not going to talk about asthma today, but suffice it to say, and if they have a question at the end, that these, many of you have heard about the atopic march, which was basically coined by Jonathan Sperger, who I think, Abdullah, you know, he trained with me many, many years ago, and now is at UPenn. But they develop asthma. If you give them one inhalation of OVA, which is shown on the left side here, left lower light, then they develop airway hyperreactivity. The reason I'm showing this slide is to remind you of something very, to remind myself to tell you something very important. There has been many attempts to use IL-4 and IL-13 blockers to treat asthma. Well, it turns out that in the case of asthma associated with this AD model, and by extrapolation maybe with children with atopic dermatitis, if you block the IL-4 and IL-13, then they shift the cells, because there is a cross inhibition, you shift the cells in the skin to make, in the body, to make much more of IL-17, which is a cytokine that attracts neutrophil. And these mice now develop still asthma, but it's a neutrophilic asthma and destructive asthma, which is hard to treat. And therefore, we need to be very careful in trying to apply Th2 blockers in cases of allergic disease if we don't know really all the background of what we are doing. Because in this case, in asthma that has been generated because now you have primarily sensitized through the skin, and sensitizing through the skin is a potent inducer of IL-17 that goes, and these cells go sit in the spleen, and if they go to the skin, they make very little IL-17 in the skin until you withdraw the IL-4, IL-13. Then the IL-17 shoots up. And when you see the antigen, you are going to develop an IL-17-driven neutrophilic destructive response, the same one that you see in cystic fibrosis or in COPD. So one has to be very, very careful based on that. But I wanted to talk about food allergy, because this is a problem, an ever-increasing problem. Now in the United States, 4 to 8% of the children have food allergy. And there is some epidemiologic data from Gideon Lack in the UK suggesting that when there was a paper many years ago in the New England Journal of Medicine, that many of the children with peanut allergy, their mothers have used when they were children peanut oil-based preparations that may have been contaminated with peanut protein, suggesting that exposure through the skin is a primary exposure. So we went on to test this hypothesis. And now we have we're collecting sera. We have also a food allergy center model. We have a very large clinical population, actually. For those who are interested, we see 26,000 patient visits a year. So these are the experimental protocol. We use the same model I told you, sensitized through the skin, or we give the mouse the antigen by mouth. Now, if they give the mouse the antigen by orally with nothing else, you tolerize the mouse. There is no immune response. And that's what happened with early feeding, probably. So after the mother breastfeeds for 3 to 6 months, one should introduce the food as early as possible after that. Unlike what the Academy of Pediatrics said 10 years ago and didn't do anything, actually, the incidence rose of food allergy. So, but if you put it with an adjuvant, in this case, toxin derived from cholera, you make a very good response. And the response you make is similar to the one with the cutaneous sensitization, with a lot of Th2 and IL-4 and IL-13 and IgE. And then you oral challenge, and you watch the mouse for the first hour. You put a little probe under the skin, and by telemetry, you measure the temperature. And you watch in the serum the appearance of a mast cell product, in this case, a tryptase called MMCP1, which also increases in human anaphylaxis. So now what happens? And what happens is very interesting. These are the skin-sensitized mice. You give them the ovalbumin, and within a short period of time, they drop their temperature. And if you and I drop our temperature for a couple of degrees in about 15 minutes, we will feel very sick. Because the only way you can drop it is by releasing mast cell products, which are shown here. So the mast, this is 5,000 to 20,000 units of MMCP1 that you release in the serum. So you are degranulating, you're undergoing anaphylaxis. And as I was telling Abdullah, as somebody who underwent anaphylaxis from a medication, it is a very unpleasant situation. You really, for those of us allergists, it's a, I don't want to wish it on anybody, but maybe we should experience it once. It's really bad. And this is IgE-mediated, because unlike in human, in mice, that you can do anaphylaxis through IgG1, but not using a platelet activating factor as a mediator. So we wanted to make sure it's IgE-mediated, so it's applicable to human. And it's IgE-mediated. One of my students, again, who Abdullah knows very well, Hans Oetgen, has made an IgE knockout mouse. And we used it here to show that they have the same IgG1 response as the normal mouse, but they do not anaphylax. So they do have IgE-mediated anaphylaxis. Now look at the orally sensitized mice. They have a very strong IgE response, as well as an IgG1 response, but they don't anaphylax. So they, and it's not a matter of being non-specifically resistant to anaphylaxis, because if you give them the same antigen intravenously, you kill them. They will anaphylax. So they have IgE, and that reflects the clinical situation in which you have children who the parents bring the child to you for evaluation. They have a positive IgE, either by skin test or RAST, but you do the challenge and they don't react. So IgE is necessary, but not sufficient for anaphylaxis. Okay? Now, the most important thing and the most surprising thing is this, because we're totally unexpected. In the cutaneously sensitized mice, compared to the unimmunized mice, compared to the orally immunized mice, there is a tremendous increase, this is game sustain, of mast cell in the wall of the GI. We didn't believe it when we saw it, so we got to another collaborator and we said, stain it differently, and they stain it with acetylcholine esterase, and you can see all these mast cells lining up right there. And it's IgE dependent, because we know IgE is a growth factor, but it doesn't happen in the PO, the orally immunized mice, so like the anaphylaxis, it's necessary but not sufficient. But the great surprise, which is also applicable to children with atopic dermatitis, is what you see in the middle. The middle frame is from mice that have been scratched without putting a specific antigen. Only saline. And these mice have an equivalent mast cell expansion, and therefore, if they make an IgE, I would predict, and we are doing this experiment, if you give them an IgE or they make an IgE to something different, they are already ready. They have a huge expansion of mast cell. Therefore, when they see the antigen that has the appropriate IgE, they get a local opening of the blood vessels, though some of those mast cells are next to the blood vessel. And in one of the previous slides, I didn't want to go into the detail, but here is the intact 37 kD antigen standard appearing in the blood of this mouse that's anaphylaxing because it has been EC sensitized. You prime the field of entry so that enough antigen will come. And now all your mast cells in the body are going to see that antigen, and that's how you anaphylax. And that is happening only when you are sensitizing through the skin, and therefore avoidance of cutaneous contact with antigen and prevention of mast cell expansion in the gut are potential strategy to combat food allergy. I only want to show you one thing at the very end, is that in the West, I don't know the incidence in Saudi Arabia or even in the Middle East, but in the West, 15 to up to 40% of the children with atopic dermatitis have a mutation in a skin-specific gene called filaggrin, which is expressed in keratinocyte, in maturing keratinocyte, and which is important for the humidity, for retention of water, and the sealing of the skin against, for its barrier function, for its sealing so that things don't come on the outside. And that's why sealing therapies are very important in atopic dermatitis. Hydrating the skin and then cover it with, mineral oil, olive oil, Crisco, whatever you have, is very important. But the mice who have this mutation, the same mutation, they're homozygous for that mutation. If you keep them living, their IgE will shoot up. It's already high and will shoot up. But most importantly, they develop spontaneous eczema. Look at this poor mouse with the swollen eyes and the ear and the nose and all that. This is the last slide, because I don't have the slide to show it to you, so I was going to tell you what it is. These mice unlike the wild type mice, if you put antigen on their skin without any scratching, just paint it with antigen, because they already, like a child with atopic dermatitis, have a permeable skin, they will make a response. If you put an antigen on a normal mouse without tape stripping, nothing happens. It's like you put some, you touch some fish, or you touch some, if you are not allergic, nothing is going to happen. But these mice, if you just put the antigen on the skin, they will develop atopic dermatitis with a lot of IL-4 in the site of the lesion. And as we would have predicted, they anaphylax if they see the, if then you give the same antigen by mouth, because you have sensitized them through the skin. And you extrapolate that to the children with atopic dermatitis, it's a direct line. You have a child who is have a permeable dry skin, the incidence of atopic dermatitis increasing, maybe pollutants, who knows, maybe dry houses, so the skin is cracking. Child sitting next to the mother or father, they are cooking, he touches the food, he starts getting sensitized through the food, he sleeps on the bed, there are dust mites, he gets sensitized through the skin, and then he sees the food by, later on, after he has been immunized as a baby, you withhold the food, and then he sees the food at 1 year of age or 2 years of age, and he develops anaphylaxis. So I think this is very relevant to making sure that we prevent antigen from coming through the skin barrier. And this is a little outdated picture in my lab. Only about four of the people here do work on atopic dermatitis, but this is the she is the major player. She's now a young staff with us, and the other people are, there are three other people who are working on various aspects, including food allergy. Thank you very much for your attention.